or an animal that hasn't been actually identified?
Well, actually, it's already been protected in Northern California, Washington, Oregon, and British Columbia.
But don't you think the government has a lot more pressing issues on their plate right now than to protect a mythical species?
All it is a signature. So this whole thing is to show people these things do exist. I mean, I've probably read every knowledgeable sighting over the last 12 and a half years, and it's just unbelievable. And also personal sightings from miners that live out in the wilderness. Now, those are the ones that really get me. I mean, it's just these guys live out there 24/7, and about 30% of them have encounters in Northern California, the ones I've talked to. So I've heard such close-up encounters describing this creature that, you know, there's no way that it's not real. I know what I saw. I know Jason. I know he's saw the same thing. And Williams, Mr. Williams in Virginia BigfootResearch.net, he had an encounter in Virginia with two other people that worked for the government that ran right across in front of him. So, you know, these things live in almost every state in the United States, except for Hawaii and Long Island, I guess, and Rhode Island. But the creature is real. I mean, I wouldn't be doing this if I didn't. If I had any doubt in my mind, I wouldn't be doing this.
All right, that. But you see, what I'm trying to get at here, and please don't take me wrong, is that you're basing the entire scenario on a film. Why not actually try to do a live capture of it?
Well, that's not my category. My category is just to film it. I don't think they need to be bothered.
All right, now, okay, so then why try and prove their existence? Because all that's going to do is drive people to try and capture them.
I don't think they can catch. Only way they're going to capture one is shoot one.
And that's exactly why the can of worms you just might be opening up.
Well, not true, because if you read on encounters by hunters, there's many a times they've had their sights or scopes on one, and when they see the head feature and body feature, they pull the gun down.
And
because
you
know, most hunters are not out there to shoot humans.
But we're not talking about the educated hunters at this point. We're talking about the people.
Country boys.
We're just talking about people who would just like to bring a Bigfoot down because now they know they exist.
Well, I believe people know they exist. And in fact, we have a group in Northern California that actually go out and hunt for it. But the problem is when you're in the woods, you're the one being hunted. And that's the problem with these things. These things know you're there and you are prey to them at any time. That's how, graceful these things are. They can be around you all night and never see it, but you can hear them. But
all right, let me ask you this question.
The odds of a hunter going out hunting for one is slim to none.
All right, you're using high-tech technology to try and prove their existence. Prove it. All it takes is someone else with high-tech technology to go out, use it as a hunting aid, and bring one down.
Well, I can give you plenty of stories where Green Beret people, military people went out there hunt for it for months at a time and come back with nothing.
Maybe it doesn't exist.
It does exist.
How come there's never been a cadaver found? How come there's never been one found on the side of the road that's been hit by a truck?
Hit by a car.
You know, there are so many questions pertaining to it.
Well, theory-wise, the ones that people do see along the side of the road are usually juveniles, and every once in a while, an adult. But the juveniles move around more. They're more playful or more imagination. I guess as they grow up and get older, the elders probably teach them, you know, this is not what you do. And yes, they have been hit by cars. One in Arkansas, they couldn't track it down with the dogs. It kept being 20, 30 feet ahead and going into the swamp. Highway 5, 12, 13 cars. One was a county mm-hmm. police with two policemen in it.
Yeah.
They seen it run right into the side of a truck and keep running across the road. And 2 days later, it comes back across. Same thing happens, but it didn't touch anything. But there was like 15 cars that time. So I can't explain why one hasn't been ran over and killed. I can say they've been hit before and maybe died out in the woods someplace.
Then how come no body of a Bigfoot has ever been found?
Well, you go kill a cow and stick it out in the woods, come back a month later, and you'll see you won't hardly have anything.
Something doesn't make sense here with this entire Bigfoot scenario.
It sure doesn't.
Something really doesn't make sense. Now, here's a question based on your own explanations over the past, 45 minutes of how smart Bigfoot is.
Uh-huh.
How do you think you're going to be able to outsmart Bigfoot?
Well, I'm taking the human factor out. I'm becoming the hunter now.
Wait a sec. You're saying you're taking the human factor out. You're becoming the hunter now. That makes no sense.
What do you mean that makes no sense? If you're on the ground, you're become the prey. And if you're in the air, you become the hunter. You understand what I'm trying to say?
So you're saying because you're going to be using an airship, you have the advantage.
I have a big advantage. I can cover about 35, 40 square miles a night. I can actually stay far away from them, not to bother them, because planes have been going over for 100 years over these areas. So they, I don't know what they react to.
Mm-hmm.
But I think they freeze when something comes over. But even if they do, I'll see them in thermal imaging.
So why just at night then? Why can't you do this during the day?
Because the thermal imaging lights up everything at night.
But if you use infrared, it would you do the same thing during the day?
I like the thermal imaging.
So it's your preference?
Yeah, well, the thing of it is, if I do run across one early morning, I will stay with it until daylight, or as long as I can. But I have a better chance at nighttime.
Why?
With thermal imaging.
Why?
Because of the programming that we're going to be using that colors every creature a different color, even a raccoon or a squirrel or a deer or a bear will come up a different color.
How does this programming work that will identify something and give it its own color coding?
I don't know exactly how it works, because I'm not a technician on electronics. But this guy in Virginia invented this piece for the people in Afghanistan war. And what it does, it color codes everything. Even a deer, like a deer will show up, mostly deer, but around the head there will be a red spot and a dark spot around the head. On a bear, most of the body will come up red. On a squirrel, the whole thing will come up red.
Have you actually seen this program work?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. I know the guy that built it.
No, that's what I was asking. Right? Have you actually seen it work, where it's been used to identify different animals?
Yeah, he uses it in Virginia.
Okay.
He's the one that developed it.
Because you're going to be hunting Bigfoot, because you're now the hunter, it's the prey.
Uh-huh.
Are you going to have to get government approval?
FAA approval.
Well, what about the forestry department? What about the people whose land you're going over?
This is how it works. The FAA, I'll start out with them, has given me a pass because it's an unmanned vehicle.
Mm-hmm.
Now, since I'm filming and doing a documentary, this is where I get my pass from. And
yeah.
I can't be within 5 miles of an airport.
All right. Now, you say you're doing a documentary. Which network is funding it?
No network. We are.
So what you're trying to do is establish a documentary and hoping by filming Bigfoot you'll be able to sell the footage.
Well, no. We're going to do the documentary ourselves. We're not going to sell it. Then we'll have to. I have a marketing person for me, and it's in this field. So it's basically, it's going to come down to is education. That's my main goal.
Are you going to be selling this film, or are you going to be giving it to the public?
Well, if there's money involved, I'm sure I'm going to get paid like I'm going to pay everybody else for the work they do.
All right, so you're doing this to make money.
I'm doing this to prove it's real, and if there's money involved, of course, I'm not going to be dumb about it. Yeah.
Well, that's not being dumb. You know, what you're doing here is you're saying, well, the reason I'm doing this is to make money.
Not true.
So then why are you going to be taking money if you're not doing this to make money?
Here's what happened in the beginning. I didn't know there was money in this when I started my project.
Really?
Okay, no, I wasn't looking for money. I was looking just to film it. That's all I was looking for, make a documentary. Come to find out, the value of it is unbelievable.
Here comes follow the money, and you always get to the root of it. That's my motto.
Well, the thing of it is, if there was no money involved, I would have done it anyway.
So why don't you do the film, and if you get it, give it to the world instead of selling it?
I'd probably set up a foundation for them to use it for education if I did it that way.
All right, stand by. We've got to take our final break. Exxon Nation, William Barnes is his name. Hunting for Bigfoot, it is his game. His website is www.bigfoot24-7.com. That's www.bigfoot24-7.com. I'll be back on the other side of this commercial break as the X Zone continues from our studios in Hamilton, Ontario, Canada. Don't go away. With each new extreme weather event or terrorist act, it becomes increasingly obvious that we live in uncertain and challenging times. We all buy car insurance. Why not collapse and catastrophe insurance? Matthew Stein, an MIT-trained engineer and green builder, has written two outstanding books to help people prepare, plan for, and deal with everything from minor situations lasting a few days to full-on collapse. Matt's first book, When Technology Fails, is a manual for self-reliance, sustainable living, and surviving the long emergency. This massive book covers the gamut from first aid and emergency preparedness to alternative healing, renewable energy, primitive living skills, and 18th century technologies that could be critical to your comfort and survival in a long-lasting crisis. Matt's second book, When Disaster Strikes, is a comprehensive emergency preparedness handbook and survival guide. When Disaster Strikes is an essential item for every family's go bag. Both books are available at all usual sources. There's a wealth of totally free information posted at whentechfails.com, and author-signed copies may be purchased at mattstein.com. That's www.whentechfails.com and www.mattstein.com. Rob McConnell here, presenting an overview for Nicholas Paul Jinnix, author of a fascinating book, Amen. It presents facts revealed by Egyptologists, facts that enable us to understand why Amen is the beginning of creation of God. It provides recommendations for religious leaders of the major religions to unify their beliefs and teach the word of God, love one another. Amen informs people how mankind conceived God. It was the Egyptians that developed the concepts of a soul, a hereafter, and son of God. And finally, after the worship of many gods, they conceived the belief in one universal God, the maker of all there is. For more information, visit www.futureofgodamen.com. That's www.futureofgodamen.com.